The great Philip Johnson is here. For more than half a century, he has been practicing architecture, and he has been at the forefront of architecture and design. He's got lots of projects, including the Glass House, the Cathedral of Hope, and the Lipstick Building here in New York. Paul Goldberg of The New Yorker has called him our most compelling architectural presence for more than a generation, and perhaps even longer than that. On July 8th, he will celebrate his 95th birthday. I am pleased to welcome my friend Philip Johnson back to this table just to check in with what's going on before we do our next interview, which will be when he's about 100. So welcome to the program.
Thank you.
How are you feeling?
I feel better and better every year.
Do you really?
Sure.
No, that's not true. Come on.
It isn't true at all. No, I don't feel well, but that's not the point.
What's the point?
Well, when you're 95, you feel 95, right?
Exactly. And 95 is not like 55. 55 is not like 25. And 25 is not like 15.
That's right, but I feel fine.
Yeah. You look wonderful.
I feel fine. Oh, yeah. Well, the makeup person is very good here. She gets better and better. I think we should just relax now and have our makeup.
That's right. I'll just send it to you every morning when you go out in public, see, and you'll look like, you know, you just came off of a movie.
I said, I think I have to put you on my payroll, I said to her this morning. No, she's good.
She would love that. Mm. Yeah. That's what, you know what we need? We need Philip Johnson the movie. That's what we need. You and I should make the Philip Johnson movie.
They would be glad to have one.
I'm sure they would. You continue to work.
Oh, yeah.
I want to talk about projects. Which should we talk about first? We can talk about the Spring Street project, because I've got a model here.
That's the one I want to talk about.
That's the one you want to talk about?
Well, I don't care. I just see it there.
Let's see the slide and have you talk about it. All right?
Sure.
There it is. You can see the slide over there. Now, I love this building. You have said that this would be the crowning achievement in your career. You still say that or not?
No, the next one.
The next one. All right. Why? But tell me why this project is important to you.
This part is important to me because it represents a new direction in modern architecture. It is, I called it for short, the revolt of the double-hung window.
The revolt of the double-hung window.
Nobody ever used them. You see, nowadays, modern glass and all that.
Yeah.
Since the invention of glass, double hungs have gone out with dodos.
Yes.
They're coming back through the back door.
Because of you.
Well, I hope so. Yeah. I'm going to do my bet for it.
Yeah. No, so what is it about the double hung window that...
Well, because it's local. It's feely. It's the way New Yorkers feel.
Yeah.
If you look at a block in New York, it's full of double hung windows.
Yeah.
So if you want to feel at home, get a big building, since that's the way New York is, you can't stop it.
Right.
But if you're not going to stop tall buildings, at least you can stop glass buildings and get that same feeling of a double hung. Double hung is just the right width to lean out.
Yeah.
It's just the right width to open and close.
I like this idea.
Sure. And so everything in that building.
Yeah, right here, the one right here, and we can see the picture there.
Well, yeah, you can see the picture, but pictures.
Yeah, they don't do justice, you think?
No, I think...
The model does justice?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that doesn't do justice either, huh?
No, hell is. Let's build it, shall we?
Yeah, let's build it. Now, this building ran into a little bit of trouble, didn't it?
Oh, yeah, we aren't going to.
You don't think it'll be built?
I do, but it'll be built in some other place.
Not in New York?
Oh, yes.
But some other location
in New York. Some other location.
Because the problem with the building is it's too high.
It's too high because that's what the locals say. Because it says so in the rules. Well, but all New York does is to
break rules.
The rules, so it doesn't bother me in the slightest. The
rules are made
and
to be broken.
Doesn't bother the owner either. He's a delightful man.
Yes.
He's the first client I've ever had that said, make me a work of art.
The first client?
First client. Well, what are there? I've got, most of them are like that.
Yeah.
Certain clients, nameless, the last time I did that, put in the article. And he wrote me a steaming note on the cover.
I mean, who was that?
Oh. 57th Street.
Yeah. 59th. But this will be built somewhere else. And
it'll be built, six of them. He wants to build six.
Right. Six of these buildings?
Yeah, he said, well, let's build six. Well,
right.
I said, fine.
Yeah, you can do it.
And we're going to build one in Rome, he says.
Yeah. In Rome?
Yeah, well.
With the double hung windows?
Well, no, we won't do that every time.
Yeah.
Maybe Rome isn't as used to double hung as we are in our old age.
But I'll say what else it has. It sort of starts narrow and then and broadens out. So
it's a sort of a cubist period.
Yeah. It's what reminded me of a cubist period.
Yeah, well, it's what it is. More like the Dutch cubism.
Yeah.
Than anything, or expressionism, whatever it is you want to use that. But the point is, it's all very loosely done. You see?
What's the fabric? What's the material?
Brick.
Brick.
New York brick.
New York brick.
Sure. See, well, here, in the picture,
you can't tell.
The lousy picture.
Yeah.
It's all carved of brick.
Yeah. What's your favorite material to work with?
Whatever's handy.
Yeah. So if it's glass, if it's brick,
glass,
if it's wood,
brick,
if it's
stone.
Yeah.
No, concrete's a favorite.
Really?
Yeah. Well, this is, for instance.
Yeah.
This could be beautiful
in concrete.
In concrete, yeah.
Yeah. Where are you, if in anywhere, in terms of where you, how you would define yourself today?
Nowhere.
Nowhere.
No, I'm totally lost.
Totally lost?
Haven't.
Mm-hmm. There's no postmodernism. There's no,
no.
word or.
Well, my best houses, for instance, are all copies of the Pantheon in Rome.
Your best houses are?
Yeah, I got four or five I'm doing now.
Yeah.
That are, each room is a little Pantheon of different size.
Why the Pantheon?
Because it makes a nice little, bulb.
Yeah.
That sits around and looks awful cute. Here's a Pantheon, there's another Pantheon.
Yeah.
Here's another Pantheon, here's another one. One house I'm doing now in New Canaan has 11 of these.
11 little Pantheons.
Little Pantheons.
Yeah. Chrysler. Looking at this, tell me what this is about. There is the Chrysler Center Trylons.
We got tired of the Chrysler building, got very boring, and it's too high in the air.
Yeah.
I can't see it.
Okay.
So we thought we'd bring the Chrysler building down to pedestrian scale.
Right.
Now, there are only three of them here, but they don't show.
Right.
These, you know, photography.
Yes.
Terrible.
Terrible.
Anyhow, it's fun to walk by them the next time you go that way.
All right. And I'll see the Trylons.
On 42nd Street, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Next slide is the Cathedral of Hope in Dallas. We love this, too.
Oh, we do. Oh, yeah.
Don't
this is fine.
Tell me, well, what's the inspiration there?
This is inspiration. It's pure concrete shape.
Yeah.
That makes things go up and down and in and out. And the whole thing is so big. It's an enormous church.
Yeah.
2006.
How long did you work on that?
Oh, I'm still working on it. I've been working on it for 6 years.
6 years?
Yeah.
Have they started construction?
No.
Not yet?
No, we're still worrying about the budget.
Still, the budget?
The budget, yeah.
You're always worrying about the budget.
Of course. That's what we do.
Worry
That's about what architects, you wonder what they do.
What do they do?
Now you know what architects do. We worry about the budget.
The Children's Museum in Guadalajara, Mexico. There's another interesting project.
That is fascinating. And that is about, see, that's four different houses, buildings, that do different things. And the children have their, on an island. We make a little island. Guadalajara, you can do anything.
Yeah.
It's wonderful to be in Mexico.
Oh, it's great, yeah.
All right, create an island.
Have you spent some time down there to get a sense of?
Yes, indeed I have. Walk the damn beaches. And since it's an island, you see, you let the children wander around on the island.
Oh, that's great.
See, and there's a place for music, a place for art, a place for painting with your fingers, and a place for looking at pictures. And it's mostly visual arts, naturally, since that happens to be the one that interests me.
Yes.
And of course, architecture. And fortunately, in this, you can't bother to see them because they're too small for the camera.
Right.
But they're great, but each one a different shape. And you get a big kick out of looking at a building that does funny things, then looking at another building that does other funny things.
Yeah, you do.
That's a big kick.
Now, if you were starting over.
Sorry, I'm what?
If you were starting your life over.
Oh, uh-huh.
Would you be an architect?
Oh, heavens, yes.
For course.
Except I'd be one earlier. I was late.
I know you were. I mean, was it at Harvard? When was it that you got the idea to go to architecture?
When I was almost too old to go to architecture.
Was after Harvard?
Yeah, Harvard. After I got
it. It was after Harvard. Yeah. Would you do, knowing what you know, knowing who you know, seeing what you have seen, listening to what you have heard, reading what you have read, would you do it differently? Would you track a different course? if you had it to do over?
Isn't it the luckiest thing in the world that I don't have to do it again? I don't know.
You don't know?
No, what difference?
I mean, there's no great turn that you wish that you had not made.
There's no great words I have for architects either.
Yeah.
Except don't be one.
Why?
Go bust. Bust.
Go bust?
Mm.
You know, it's too hard, too many, too few people are doing well in architecture?
Too few people are doing well in architecture for obvious reasons. Architecture's too hard.
Too hard?
Yeah.
What's hard about it?
How would you get it the right size to it and please the client?
Yeah, that's the hardest thing. How about pleasing yourself? How hard is that?
That's the hardest.
That's the hardest, yeah.
So come with talking to you. You know too much about artists. Yeah.
That is true about artists, yeah. Isn't it?
Oh.
Pleasing themselves.
Oh, terrible.
Yeah. This town is celebrating knees in two separate
museums. Yeah.
What do you think of all this?
I don't, well, of course, I'm not so fond of knees as the historians are, and we didn't get along very well. And why should we? You know, he's an older gentleman and a great influence on me, obviously, and a great architect. But after that, why should I celebrate him? It's important for me to get going too, you know.
We have been celebrating you every year of your life.
Not every year, dear.
Well, every
5 years, whatever you say. You know better than I do. These facts escape me.
But more about Mies.
Mies, yeah.
Yeah, Mies, I mean.
Mies. He's a very great man, but...
Why didn't you get along?
Because he didn't like me. And that, of course, is the greatest sin of all, isn't it? And I don't know what's wrong with me, but I wasn't a good enough pupil. My buildings were not good enough Musuem buildings.
Yeah.
They were good my buildings,
yeah.
But they didn't please the great man. So he decided to cross me off his list, which is fine.
Did you feel rejected?
Oh, yes. Oh, all those things. Oh, I think everyone separates, feels all these rejections.
Why is he a great man?
Because he did the greatest buildings of his time. I mean, they still, you go back and you earn it all about the skill and the greatness of the designs.
What was it about the designs that you thought made them great?
I can't make it as clear as I can with a copy of a Roman temple. But because he made the original buildings.
Yeah.
He didn't need any fingers to help him. See, I need crutches. I think we all do.
What kind of crutches do you need?
I need crutches like using, in this case, of those few houses, the Pantheon.
Yeah. You need something that inspires you, that gives you a...
Get me going.
A going.
How would I make a house look like a Roman or an Arab village if I didn't have a copy of a house that everyone recognizes proportions. See, if you recognize the Pantheon proportions, the dome and the drum, if you didn't see that, you wouldn't know how high the building was. See, you see the Pantheon, and you'll know exactly how high the door has to be. Clear, everything's right there. It's half the height.
Yeah.
And that is a great crush. And you got to have something. Whatever Mies used for crutches, almost nothing, or whatever his slogan is.
How about Frank Lloyd Wright?
Frank Lloyd Wright invented a new slogan every 10 minutes. Sure. Oh, no. Frankie was very good at slogans. Oh, no. Artists need the help of a crutch.
Yeah.
It doesn't make a difference if they admit it or not. You know. I mean, Frank Lloyd Wright thought he was original genius. Well, he was. The original you get.
He was.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. How many geniuses have you known in architecture?
The two, I think.
Frank.
And
Mies
van der Rohe.
Those two?
No, you have to add Corby Sheen.
Of course you do, otherwise we wouldn't be able to wear those glasses.
This isn't Corby Sheen.
Is that not?
This is
oh, I always thought they were Courbet glasses.
No, they're better.
They're better. They're Johnson glasses.
They're Johnson, but they're pure circles.
They are pure circles?
And not Courbet.
Can I put them on 1 second?
Try. Oh, you're made for them.
Here you go.
Say that to all the boys.
If you were today, had somebody come to you and had a G5, the fastest, a great jet, private jet, and said, Philip, let's you and I go see the 5 greatest buildings in the world as you determine, where would you go?
I'd have to talk, I think, for 5 minutes, or 6,
okay.
Or 4.
Okay, name, what would probably be on the list? Pantheon.
Pantheon, yeah, but sure. Much down the list.
Okay.
Of the great ones,
okay.
Would be the Pantheon, the Parthenon.
Parthenon.
Parthenon would be number one.
Right.
Then there'd be Michelangelo's, well, there are 2 or 3 in Michelangelo.
Right.
You'd have a hard time.
Right. Did he do St. Peter's Basilica?
St. Peter's? You might down the list. Somewhere.
Yeah, right. Okay, what else?
Oh, of course. Chartres.
Yeah, Chartres would have to be there, wouldn't it?
Oh, would to me.
You've always said to me that's the one thing you should see when you go to Europe.
Of course.
What else? Anything in the United States? Frank Lloyd Wright. Falling Water or not, or what?
No, not Falling Water. No, I like some of the buildings more. You could figure it out later if you get the G5.
If I get the G5, will you go?
Not only that, but I'll make a list and knock your eyes off.
We should do that. Right. You know what we could do?
What?
You and I could do that. We'll get the G5,
get you.
We'll get a chef on the plane. A chef. We've got to have food.
Food.
Can't go without food. And we'll invite our 10 favorite friends, and we'll go see the 5 greatest buildings in the world. You want to do this?
Let's do that.
All right. You're up for this? We need to do this before you go to become 100. No, we can't. We only got 5 years now.
We had chilly-shally around.
We can't chilly-shally around. We have a time clock for this project. All right?
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
Now, what is it you most want to be working on right now? What project?
Well, I'm still on the little Pantheon.
You still on that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm doing one in New Canaan. I'm doing one in Southampton. I'm doing one, you know, around.
Yeah. Are you, in your own mind, more of a follower than an initiator?
Yeah. I think so.
That's just...
Isn't that awful? I suffer.
You suffer? I mean, do you wish otherwise that you've been more of a initiator? I mean, you have been a definer, a follower, and a definer.
That's right.
Right? But not an initiator so much of great new ideas.
No, that's right. I don't think anybody is, though.
Not many.
No.
You could name them on your right hand.
At that.
Or one finger.
Charlie Rose.
Yeah, well, I'm not sure about that.
Sure.
When you look, what excites you most about the future and where we are?
The hope that someday clients and developers will develop a taste for good architecture and the willingness to spend what it takes to create it. You see, the catch is that most developers are not interested in architecture, they're interested in money.
Commerce,
well, why not?
Yeah.
That's their business. And I think they ought to be more interested in beauty. But beauty, you see, is not very rewarding. Trump is a good example. It was Trump that I used in my quote.
Yes, I know. And he got upset and wrote you a nasty letter?
What a nasty letter. He was right.
Yeah. Probably claimed credit for making you, too.
He said, look, you took my money And now you say these terrible things about me. You seem to have a little more noblesse oblige, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
That you owe me just the fact that I gave you a chance, Philip Johnson, to build 3 or 4 buildings on the Hudson River.
Yeah.
That's something, isn't it?
Yeah, it's something.
No, no, he's right.
He's right?
Oh, yeah.
He's got a point.
Oh, sure. John wrong.
check one for the Donald.
Chuck one for the Donald. Yeah.
You've got to help me understand and think about your life and all right. the things you have done right. and all the things you wish you could do, you know? Tell me what you're proudest of.
Tell me what my...
What you are proudest of.
Proudest of?
Yeah.
There's a couple of places where I stand and look at some of my buildings and brings tears to my eyes.
Where?
That's putting me on the spot.
It is. And I want you to answer.
Well, just now, because I'm working on it, there are some parts of these villages I'm building.
Right. Where
each house is a village. See? That wonderful sense of clumped. Clumped round towers.
Yeah.
It's so wonderful that you see one or two places and you say, oh, that's it. Mm-hmm. And you hit it. And you only catch a little bit, you only catch a glimpse, you only catch a half a look. But that's what keeps you alive.
Yeah. I will never forget the moment, ever, that you and I first walked into Frank Gehry's building.
Which one? In Bilbao?
In Bilbao.
When tears came in my eyes.
Tears came into your eyes. And I said to you, why are you crying? And you said, it's so beautiful. You had been so touched by...
Yeah, the shapes.
Shapes.
Mm-hmm. Simple as that.
That's what you are in the end. I mean, it is this love.
That's right.
Of form and beauty.
That's all.
Love of it.
It's love. Yeah. And love is what makes the world go round, they tell me. I mean, if I read right. and money doesn't. So I'll die poor, which I've always wanted to. And poorer than I thought I was going to, but that's all right. And but that's all right if I make enough of the beauty part. Mm. I don't know whether it'll be the thing in Guadalajara, or whether it'll be one of the houses.
Well, pantheons, or?
Pantheons are one of those things.
Or the Cathedral of Hope, or?
Oh, that would be, yeah. That would be a dream, really.
You are amazing. You really, you are.
I'm a failure.
You are not a failure.
Well, partly.
You know what, now here's the story. You're talking about dying poor. You've given away your art.
Yeah, I gave
to
away.
To the Museum of Modern Art, I think. I can't remember.
I did that because I wanted the money to be used. Mm. See, that money was a little bit when I put it in, and after I gave it, I turned out it was worth $20 million. I was very surprised.
But if you know it's worth $20 million,
$20 million. Well, that's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah. Yeah. And I didn't get it. I gave it to the Modern.
Yeah.
But. That, of course, helped me get kudos and right. pleasure and satisfaction.
And it hangs there for lots of people to enjoy.
That's right.
To enjoy.
They'll all enjoy the pictures, and they must be good or they wouldn't be worth so much, I always say.
It shows you had a great eye.
Yeah. Well, I had some help, don't forget.
Well, of course, you knew everybody.
Yeah.
And you had a relationship. That's a great relationship you had with the Modern.
With the Modern, yeah. Well, I had a great leader, Alfred Barr.
Yeah, Alfred Barr was gave you an opportunity to be the architectural curator.
That's right. So everything was happy, and everything's best in the best possible world. Mm.
And we'll come back and do this
5 years.
5 years from now.
Okay.
1 year, 100.
100.
Philip Johnson at 95. I love you. You're a great man. Thank you. El Greco is perhaps one of the most admired and least understood masters of European painting. His life's journey took him from Crete to Italy and finally to Spain. Along the way, he transformed his art by a complex process of adaptation. Although El Greco's style was inventive, he frequently repeated his compositions and copied himself. Now, 7 of his paintings are on display together for the first time at the Frick Collection in New York. This exhibit examines his unique approach to his work and traces the scope and evolution of his career. Joining me now on location at the Frick Collection is Jonathan Brown. He is the curator of the exhibit El Greco, Themes and Variations. Why is El Greco so important as a painter?
I think he's one of the great individualists in the history of painting. It's very rare to come across a painter who has developed a style that everybody can recognize at first glance. And I think that behind this is a sense of daring to the approach of painting that is really quite extraordinary, if not unique for his time.
How do you explain that daring?
Well, I think he was the kind of a painter who decided to be an original right from the start, and he was. He had a background that is unparalleled in the 16th century in that he started out in the island of Crete in the eastern Mediterranean and then became a fully developed, mature painter in the Byzantine style, whereupon he threw it all over, came to Italy, and decided to make himself over, so to say, into an Italian painter. And the idea always was that here was a fellow who was from the outside. He wasn't a mainstream painter. And for those who have lived on the outside, I think you recognize that it's an interesting place to inhabit. Not easy, because, of course, you're always subject to self-doubt, you're always subject to criticism. But at the same time, you have a lot of freedom. And it's that freedom that El Greco had of being the outsider that allowed him to develop this highly original style of painting.
Being as good as he is and as recognized as he is now, fame came relatively late?
Yes, indeed it did. He was born in 1541 on Crete. In 1567, he came to Italy. He spent 10 years in Italy trying to establish a career, never succeeded in doing it.
But not in Florence, not in Venice, not where you are, not in Rome.
No, in the major capitals, because he was a big hitter. I mean, he was not interested in a quiet provincial life with a sort of steady clientele, although in a way that's what he ended up with. But then he said, well, I want to be famous, I want to be rich, it's not happening here, let's try Spain. And of course, Spain in the 16th century was the leading European power.
But some say he's not even understood well.
You know. I would be the first to say that, and I've spent my entire life working
on it. Trying to explain that.
No, what happens is that when you find an artist who is so markedly different and so markedly original, you open the door to every kind of explanation. And so we've had some that are frankly ludicrous, where he had defective eyesight and was just painting, as it were, what he saw in this defective way. Some think he was influenced by the great mystics of 16th century Spain. Others, myself included, believe that he was just an extraordinary personality with a real desire to be rich, to be famous, and to be original. And he was not an easy fellow to get along with either.
Had an ego, had an arrogance, had a...
Yes, this is something that has emerged very clearly in the last 20 years or so. It had long been known that in Spain, he was involved in a series of lawsuits involving the payment for his commission.
Yes.
And it wasn't until about 1982 or thereabouts that a historian of Spanish law, Professor Richard Kagan at Johns Hopkins, studied these lawsuits from the legal point of view. And what he discovered was that these lawsuits were doomed to fail. They were doomed to fail because the system was stacked against El Greco or any artist. But that never stopped him from suing. He sued and lost and sued and lost and sued and lost, and finally fell into financial ruin because it cost him a lot of money. And we all know that the law courts are the last place to find justice, and he found that out, but it never sunk in to any great extent.
Let me go back to his journey from Crete to Venice in search of what?
Well, I think my guess would be that he was just bogged down in that provincial milieu. And I think, as we know, he was a man with a great deal of pride, bordering on arrogance. And he thought, he knew, because Crete was a Venetian possession, that he had a much better chance of achieving his goals as an artist and as a person if he went to Italy. But that was an amazingly bold step to take, because the Venice he was coming to was the Venice of Titian, it was the Venice of Tintoretto, it was the Venice of Veronese. And how he thought he could compete in that milieu is very difficult to decide.
What was Titian's influence on him?
I think Titian had a profound influence on El Greco. There are two competing visions for representing the world in 16th century Italy. And one is based on the use of color and the approximation of the art of painting to nature. And the other is based on design or line or drawing, which was characteristic of Florence, and sought a perfect kind of symmetry. Titian was the leading representative of the coloristic school. And I think when El Greco saw these paintings by Titian, he just was absolutely, he went overboard.
When did he begin this idea of repeating himself?
Well, it's a long-standing tradition in Byzantine painting. The compositions acquire a sacred or holy character, and they're repeated and repeated and repeated.
But in his case, with some modification.
With some modification. Although, with the four paintings that we have in the exhibition of the purification of the temple, I think you're struck initially by the fact that, gosh, he's used the same composition.
Right.
Couldn't he think up another one, for God's sakes? But then as you...
Can we take this theme somewhere else?
Yeah, exactly. And I think that the exhibition has two aspects to this repetition.
Right.
One is using the same composition over a 40-year period in his career. But the other has to do with the way his career developed in Toledo. Because he was a difficult, arrogant, contentious person, he alienated some of his most important patrons. The Cathedral of Toledo, he got into a terrific squabble with them. He sued them and over the payment. And Philip II, he painted a picture for Philip II, and he misjudged Philip II's taste. And again, he fought over
Philip money. II didn't like it.
Didn't like it. He took this picture, which we, the martyrdom of St. Maurice and the Theban Legion, which we regard as one of his masterpieces, was removed from the altarpiece as soon as El Greco left town, and they put another one in its place. So he's got to earn a living, and so he begins to, he follows a practice that was common in Venice, which is to set up a kind of factory for reproductions. And we know that it existed because somebody visited him in 1611 and saw what he called small originals of everything that he had painted. What he was looking at was a kind of sample case. And so a patron or a client would walk in and say, I'll take this one, I want it this size, and I want you to paint it. And El Greco said, okay, you, for that, for those three stipulations, it's gonna cost you 50 ducats,
yeah.
Done. And he would reproduce.
Yeah.
So there, it's a commercial operation. You know, we talk sometimes in terms of English tailoring about bespoke clothing,
right.
And off the peg. Well, El Greco offered these two options.
Take the purification. How many? Four?
There are these four.
Right.
But then there are probably another seven or eight out there, many by him, some by assistants.
How about St. Jerome?
St. Jerome was a more special theme. There are only, in addition to the three we have here, I think there are three more. But so St. Jerome was not one of the major popular saints of his time.
The Frick also has how many Vermeers?
Three.
Got three Vermeers here. We don't, although new ideas about learning more from Delft, a recent exhibition at another museum here, we know a lot about Vermeer.
No, apparently, well, I was actually, I watched the program that you did with Walter Liedtke, which I thought was very informative. We don't know much about Vermeer as a person. We don't know nearly as much about Vermeer as a person as we do about El Greco.
That's where I'm going. That's exactly my point. What do we know about him?
Well, El Greco was a very proud, arrogant, difficult person. He was the kind of person that seemed to have a natural talent for making enemies. He was the kind of person that I think...
Litigious.
Litigious, for sure. And I think he was the kind of person who was even difficult with his friends. I think many of us have known people who are very attractive, for different reasons. We find them compellingly attractive, and yet at the same time, they treat us terribly. And El Greco had that kind of personality, I think. Here, I'm fantasizing a little bit, but on the basis of documented facts.
So what do we know about his family, El Greco? What do we know about, you know, and what influence that had? What do we know about his physical health?
Well, he lived to be a fairly ripe old age, as these things go in the 16th century, where the average age, the average mortality was somewhere in the 40s, and he made it close to 70. He met a woman when he arrived in Toledo with whom he lived, but whom he never married. They had a son, Jorge Manuel, who later joined El Greco's workshop, and he also inherited El Greco's personality, very ornery cuss. Himself.
Creative though, a talented painter?
Not like his father, but a good painter and even a better architect.
Yeah.
And I think that El Greco liked to live well. That was one of, he sued for two reasons.
Yes. He wanted the money.
He wanted the money. And also, money then as now was a way of measuring value. Yeah. You know, we see it around us all the time, and living as we do in a kind of a non-spiritual world, the money has acquired even more importance than it did in the 16th century.
As someone said, it's how we keep score.
Exactly. But it also allows you, you know, I mean, I came up here in a subway. If I'd been rich, I would have had a nice car at my disposal.
What about this notion about him having an astigmatism?
I have astigmatism, and no.
But it has been suggested, hasn't
it? It has.
And you made the great remark that if he had an astigmatism, so did everybody else in the town.
Yeah, exactly.
Who liked art.
Exactly. No. I think what happens is that the extraordinary originality of El Greco, as I've said, calls out for explanations. And this is a very simple one. You can get your mind around this very easily. But, of course, art is thought. Art is pondering. Art is experimentation. Art is not bad eyesight.
Never has been.
Never has been. Never has been. I don't even know how effective they had. I wonder, how effective were the World War in 16th century Spain?
So what was the reception to the work at the time?
He hit the right chord. They loved him. They loved him because the Toledo he went to in 1577 was, in many respects, an artistic backwater. And here comes this flashy artist from Rome with this extremely flashy, brilliant style. The colors are vibrating. Mm. The figures are writhing and moving in every direction. And they love him. The only problem, of course, we come back to is that he just couldn't, he couldn't be satisfied with all that he had.
And he was always reaching.
Always reaching. And that's what makes him a great artist, but it would have made him a very difficult person.
Why were St. Jerome and the purification of the temple chosen?
Well, let's begin with St. Jerome. St. Jerome is a saint that became particularly significant in the late 16th century. He was the author of the Vulgate, which is the translation from Hebrew and Greek into Latin of the Bible. And the Vulgate was much criticized by biblical scholars and Protestants for its lack of accuracy. However, the Council of Trent decreed that it would be the standard Bible for the Christian world. And in 1592, they published a new edition of the Vulgate, which ratified the belief in the authenticity of this translation. I think El Greco's painting, which dates to around 1595, reflects the publication of this edition. Furthermore, in 1595 itself, a very famous Spanish writer who was a member of the Hieronymite order, the order founded in theory by St. Jerome, wrote a defense of the representation of St. Jerome as a cardinal. St. Jerome was not a cardinal. He died in 420. The College of Cardinals wasn't created until the end of the 11th century. And the red vestments that they wear were not brought into use until the 13th and 14th century. So the writer in Spain said, no, even though we know that St. Jerome wasn't a cardinal, he is a cardinal in our eyes. And this was a kind of moment for somebody in Toledo to commission this portrait of St. Jerome, the one that's in the Frick collection. The purification of the temple similarly responds to religious concerns. The purification of the temple is the act by which Christ drives the moneylenders and the merchants out of the temple where they are defiling the temple. And the painting refers in part to Protestants and also to those who were conducting abusive practices in the Catholic Church. It's the best Counter-Reformation theme. We're going to purify ourselves. We're going to get rid of these moneylenders and their animals and their coins, and the church will be a place of worship.
His genius, I'm repeating myself, his genius in these paintings is what?
Well,
other than the fact that they leap off the canvas.
I wouldn't be so quick to dismiss that.
All right, I'm not dismissing anything. I'm trying to go deeper in terms of what we have here in these specific paintings,
right,
as reflective of greatness.
Well, let me begin with Saint Jerome, which is a painting that I love very much. And I think I see it as a kind of psychological autobiography. El Greco was a man from the East, from the Eastern Mediterranean. Saint Jerome, though born in Dalmatia, spent a large part of his life in Syria and in Palestine. And Saint Jerome, like El Greco, was a famously contentious person. He attacked the church. He was difficult to get along with. And he was an outsider, just as El Greco was. When El Greco received this commission, I think he said to himself, I know this guy, he's me. And so he put a huge amount of psychological energy into this portrait of Saint Jerome. And when you look at this portrait, you see somebody who looks difficult. There's a kind of gnarled, cramped, it's almost as if, you know, somebody's walked into his office, right, he's right in the midst of something, and he's saying, please, get out of here, can't you see I'm busy?
Yeah.
And although saying it in rather abrupt terms, and these are all qualities that come into the painting. At the same time, when you look closely at it, you can see that it appears to be a painting that El Greco improvised as he painted. There are parts, for example, the cape, the red cape that is worn by Saint Jerome has been repainted, it's been lengthened, and you can see the original faint outline of the first version of it over which he's painted. So he's making these adjustments all the time. And the painting is alive, it vibrates, it's got this tremendous psychological and pictorial energy that for me makes a great masterpiece.
Okay, well, stay with me on that idea and on Saint Jerome. There's a Saint Jerome that's part of the permanent collection of the Frick. There's a Saint Jerome that you brought over from the Met. What's the difference in the two?
Well, the Saint Jerome at the Met was painted probably 20 years later.
Right.
Now, it's a replica. El Greco has already created the image in the Frick version, so that kind of improvisation doesn't exist.
Right.
However, and this is a point that was made in a review, which I thought was very well done, in the Wall Street Journal by Matthew Gurewitch. He said, you know, copies can also be performances. And he cites specifically the case of dancers, of actors, who repeat themselves constantly and try in the repetitions to capture something of the spirit of that original moment.
Right.
And I thought that was a very good point. He went so far as to say that there was an element in the exhibition which the curators themselves hadn't realized, and he was right. And when I read what he said, I said, you know, that's an extremely good point.
Here's another question then. When you put together this, how long was it in the making?
Well, I've been studying El Greco for 30 years.
So it's in your head been in the making for 30 years.
Right, but we started the actual planning of the exhibition about 2 years ago.
Okay, so, and you've got seven paintings, and you got four, you had four, so you got three to go. When you get them on the wall, do you learn anything at all?
Oh my God, that's, you know, I mean, frankly, if I were the only person to attend the exhibition, I would think it was a success. It's terrific. I mean, it's very exciting.
Well, what do you learn?
Well, just actually before we started this interview, I was looking at the paintings again, and I noticed the first version of the purification of the temple. And I'd always noticed that the colors seem kind of muddy, they're kind of clotted. And then it came to me, and I said, my God, this guy doesn't even know how to mix Western pigments yet, how to make oil paints. And so you get a kind of collapse in certain parts of the painting. It's a very experimental work. you get a collapse of some of the pigments. And I'd never thought of that before, that not only is it a learning piece in terms of composition, in terms of figure style, but in terms of technique itself, it's also a learning piece. Then when you take a look at the two St. Jeromes, and even the third one that's come from a private collection in Spain, particularly the last one that comes from this private collection in Spain, must have been done quite near the end of El Greco's life. And you'll notice that he makes much more lavish use of white pigments, so that it differs quite dramatically from the first version that he did around 1595. And it's the same approach to painting, these intense whites that you see, for example, even in the purifications.
Does this mean that it is the original that's always the most valuable?
Well, nowadays we would think so. Nowadays, the distinction between originals and copies is very clear in our minds. Originals are worth a lot and copies are not. And I think probably there's no point in swimming against that tide.
Right. But at the same time, great museums will want copies, well, simply because of the greatness of the artist.
Exactly. As long as they're, you know, works by the artist, I think
we're not turning down El Greco.
No, sir. No, sir.
There are fewer. Purification of the temple. You know, why? Well, tell me what that painting is about.
Well, Christ is visiting the temple, and he sees that stalls has been set up, people are selling animals, money changers are at work. This is the Jewish temple, and he's outraged, and he decides to cleanse the temple of all of these unholy activities. And so he makes what is called in the Gospel of John a whip of cords, and he charges into the midst of these guys and these women that are doing these unclean activities, and literally just drives them out of the place. He, you know, beats them into retreat. And this is what you see in all of these paintings. On the left-hand side of the paintings, you see the merchants that are defending themselves against Christ's blows and trying to get the hell out of there.
Why did El Greco choose this subject?
I think it probably was chosen for him, because it's a fairly recondite subject. It's not one of the most popular subjects in Christian art. But it did have this a certain degree of popularity in the second half of the 16th century. So I think it's a
good question.
Yeah, sometimes you don't always have the answers.
Hey, he may not have had the answer. What's the most popular, is the birth the most popular thing in Christian painting? Is it the manger scene,
well,
some variation, or the Last Supper, one of the other?
The crucifixion.
Crucifixion,
yes. The crucifixion.
By far.
Yes, it's Christ's sacrifice that redeems mankind, and offers the hope of salvation.
Did El Greco leave, did he reflect, did he write, did he leave anything that gave us some insight into his head?
He wrote marginal notations to two books that he had in his library. He had a library of about 120. We know this because there was a complete inventory of all his possessions when he died.
Done by him?
Done by his son.
Right.
And he owned about 120 books. And almost miraculously, two of these books have surfaced in the last couple of decades. One is Vasari's Lives, which was acquired by a Spanish art historian who was also an antiquarian bookseller. He bought the book, he opened it up, saw the marginal scribblings, and eventually was able to prove that they had been written by El Greco. And then about 20 years ago, two young Spanish art historians working in the Biblioteca Nacional in Madrid came across a volume of Vitruvius, which had been published in Venice in the mid-16th century, and this had much more extensive notes. For me, these volumes were tremendous for everybody.
Okay, let me understand this. They knew that they had a book that belonged to El Greco because of the inventory?
It was known he owned these books.
Yeah.
And then the handwriting in the margin, he had a very beautiful script.
So they instantly knew it was his handwriting.
Exactly.
For some reason, believe it might have been a book that he had and then
correct.
The handwriting.
Correct.
And so what do we learn from these notations?
Well, you know, it's like suddenly a silent artist has gained a voice. And a lot of the conjecture goes out about what he's thinking. Now, they're fascinating because in Vasari, he goes down the list of famous painters and he gives his reaction. Titian, he praises to the sky.
Right.
Michelangelo, he admires as a draftsman, but he's very clear that Michelangelo was a terrible painter.
Wait, here's what's interesting to me. Did he once say, why don't you let me redo that?
It's a legend that he's the Last Judgment. I mean, he could have said it. He certainly could have said it. I mean, it's psychologically, it is of a piece, and also aesthetically.
New definition of hubris, doesn't it?
It is indeed. Not a shy guy, though. Right?
No. You could understand how somebody might, it's like a contemporary painter who we all know saying, I'm as good as Picasso. You
know? Right. It's one thing to say it, and it's one thing to do it, right? Well, Greco did it. Let's give him credit.
He did it, but so he could have, well, he couldn't
have
bested.
Yeah, he definitely could have said it.
Couldn't have bested Michelangelo.
Listen, there you get into a matter of taste. I think that, who am I to say the Sistine Ceiling isn't the greatest work of art ever done, but on the other hand, I think there are paintings by, the Burial of the Count of Orgaz is about as great a painting as I've ever seen. This is in the Church of Santo Tomé in Toledo, and it's fabulous, fabulous picture.
The greatest painting you have ever seen because of your own judgment, interest?
Well, listen, here I'm going to hedge like scholars are paid to do and say one of the greatest paintings.
You want people to come away from this exhibition because it is unique in that it's seven. It is an extraordinary painter. It is a chance to look and compare, and it is a chance to see redundancies as well as modifications. With what experience?
I think with the idea that the art of painting is very complex. I think it's an exhibition that limits the number of paintings and thus invites the viewers to study each of them carefully. It invites the viewers to consider the whole question of replicas, of repetitions, of originals versus later versions by the same artist. It invites people to come in and have a reduced but intense experience of the art of painting at its highest level.
Thank you. Pleasure. Very much.
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next show, I lose Lord Snowden on his photographs and Alan Dershowitz on the Bush-Gore election.